Ladies and gentlemen, it is common practice to introduce celebrities in one's audience, but often the men who have done most for the world are not in the spotlight. I'd like you to meet in my audience a man who has done much for young people, the founder and head of Boys Village in Arizona, Dr. Everett Wexler. Mr. Wexler, would you take it off? Dr. Wexler, good evening. How are you, and how are things at Boys Village?
Very, very fine, thank you.
Good. I'm very glad that... Oh, hi. Dr. Wexler, this is my dear friend, Bernie. Both my friends, Bernie and Harriet Zimmerman. And tell us, Dr. Wexler, how are things at Boys Village? I mean, are things going...
Well, they're proceeding very well.
That's... excuse me just a moment, Doctor. Harriet? Harriet, dear, you're crying. What is it?
It's nothing important, Jerry.
It's nothing important? Well, if it's making Harriet cry, it's important. Tell me, honey, what is it?
Oh, it's nothing at all, Jerry. Just go finish the show. I'll just sit here and cry my heart out.
All right, fine, Harriet. What is it, Bernie? What's wrong?
It's our daughter, Rosalie.
Rosalie? What's wrong with Rosalie, Harry?
Rosalie had a little difference of opinion with her parents. She's a very sensitive girl.
She's a tramp. Rosalie is becoming a tramp.
I gave birth to her, Jerry. I carried her in my body.
But Rosalie is a little girl, Harriet.
Not so little. She's 18 and she has the body of a 33-year-old woman.
Rosalie is 33?
38, 24, 36.
Little Rosalie?
It's your fault. You should have never let her do those exercises.
Harriet, you're exaggerating the problem. I'm sorry, Dr. Wexler, but you see...
Exaggerating? All she's going around with is wild boys. I never want to see her again.
That's the way you feel about it, Mama.
Rosalie... You're a big girl, Rosalie.
It's those exercises. Bernie, she looks a little pale.
She's no daughter of mine.
Bernie, what...
Tell me what this is all about. I mean, since we're involved, I might...
I'm in love with a boy, Uncle Jerry.
He's a bum.
He's a bum.
You can't call me a bum, Mrs. Zimmerman.
Don't listen to my mother, Bradley.
Oh, what kills me, Jerry, is Rosalie was going with such a fine boy from such a lovely family. Leon Kupperman.
Leon Kupperman.
His father is a doctor,
doctor.
His mother is a surgeon.
And his mother's
Leon
a surgeon.
Leon Kupperman is as dull as dishwater.
Now, that isn't fair.
He's right, Mr. Lewis. I am dull as dishwater.
I find you exciting, Leon.
Well...
Thank you, Mrs. Kupperman.
Listen, Harriet, Bradley, I mean, folks, Bradley may be a nice boy. You can't judge people by their clothes. I mean, Bradley, that is... you may dress in an unusual way, but I'm sure you're basically a decent boy, aren't you, Bradley? And you do have plans to marry Rosalie, right?
What for?
You see? He's a bum, Jerry, a bum.
Well, wait a minute, Harriet. You can't go around calling this young man a bum. That's not fair, you see.
Ask him what he does for a living.
All right, fine. What do you do for a living, son?
Nothing.
He's a bum. All right. Don't you ever want to have a job or anything like that?
What you want to be, Bradley?
Yeah, a prison guard.
You want to be a prison guard. Well, that's
what
nice.
What kind of life is that for a girl living in prison, Jerry?
Well, now, easy, Bernie. Take it easy.
We did not raise our daughter to go to prison, Jerry.
Harriet, when you're right, you're right.
Sure,
try to
you
calm
can talk.
Yourself.
You don't have a daughter who wants to marry a prison guard.
Suppose you want me to marry that klutz Leon.
Well, what do you want to do? What do you want to do, klutz?
I'm studying to be a warden.
A warden,
either
wonderful.
Way, she ends up in prison.
Mother,
yeah.
Please.
Well, you see...
Oh, I don't blame it on you, Rosalie. It's the men today. They're all animals. I mean, even a woman my age. Just last
Harriet,
week...
Harriet, we're on the air.
Last week, in the subway, I was accosted by an old man.
Yeah, all right, Harriet, fine. Dr. Wexler,
wait a minute!
Sorry.
That's him! That's him! That's
you're
the man!
Dr. Bernie, Wexler? Well, wait a minute. Now, hold it a second. Dr. Wexler couldn't be the man. I never saw... Fran, you know...
The Jerry Lewis Show. Starring Barbara Feldon. With special guest star, Dean Jones. And of course, Jerry Lewis.
and a pleasant good evening to you, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our show. I must tell you of an incident that happened just coming to the studio this afternoon. I was,
Did you want it over here or over there? Hello? Hey, did you want it?
What I was trying to say is... Could you move? You're blocking. It's not a nice way. I'm a star. They know me.
Anytime you find you want to lose the blues, you can do it with a funny pair of shoes. I don't care, take any pair of shoes you choose. And you'll feel good right away. You will shout, hip, hip, hooray,
hooray.
And you'll stand right up and say, I love my slippy, sloppy shoes. They make me feel so light and gay. And in my slippy, sloppy shoes, the world is better right away.
And though I try a newer pair,
I put them on and get the blue. I take them off again to wear.
My happy slippy sloppy shoes.
They feel so good.
Oh, what a treat.
I walk with wings.
Upon my feet.
I skip and hop. Along the street. And dance hello to folks I meet.
My friends all tease me night and day.
And think I'm nutty as can be.
They tell me throw the things away. I smile and answer, no siree.
And though the rest of me is dressed up in my Sunday best, I choose to wear my slippy sloppy shoes. My happy slippy sloppy shoes.
Hi.
What are you doing in this neck of the woods?
I grew up here. That just goes to prove you always ignore the tree next door.
What kind of tree are you?
Pussy willow. What are you?
Me? I'm a mighty oak. Oh. I'm a he-man. Are you alone?
Uh-huh. I'm an orphan. My folks were chopped down.
I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. Daddy's a ferry boat in Hoboken, and Mommy's a tract house in Van Nuys.
Boy, you sure have great limbs. In fact, you're built like a brick tree.
Well, it's a lot better than being called Twiggy.
I gotta go along with you on that. Say, what are your measurements?
36, 24, 36.
Wow.
They hang a lot of hammocks on me.
Boy, I can't wait until autumn to watch your leaves fall. Would you like to hold branches for a while?
Fresh. I'm a nice tree.
Oh, what's a nice tree like you doing on a forest like this? Miss Willow, I know I'm not much to look at. And my sap is always running, but... will you marry me? I mean, you and I could make beautiful forests together.
Don't be ridiculous. You're much too old for me.
I'm only 520 years old.
But I'm only 150. And just think, when you're 800, I'll only be 430. It'll never work. I'm afraid I cannot marry you.
Oh, cruel love. You know, I never really told this to anyone before. But I'm not a tree. I'm really a handsome prince under the spell of a wicked witch.
No! How corny!
And if you'll kiss me, you'll break the magic spell and I'll be free.
Okay.
You see, I did not lie. True love broke the wicked witch's spell. I am Prince True Heart, handsome as the devil. Will you marry me?
No, it can never be.
Why not?
I'm a tree.
Ladies and gentlemen, tonight I have a big, wonderful surprise for you. And if you have little children, make sure they see this. Open it up, Harry. Punch and Judy, probably the oldest form of entertainment for children. I've been working on this for months, and tonight I'm going to put on an authentic Punch and Judy show. Now, kiddies, the Punch and Judy show is about to begin. Close it up, Harry. I'm not going to have this ruined. What are you looking for?
My lunch.
Your lunch? What's your lunch doing on my stage?
You don't expect me to leave it over on stage three, do you?
Why not?
They're doing a big comedy show over there.
What do you think I'm doing?
Well, if you're trying on hats, my taste leans towards something, you know, with a little lower crown and maybe a little wider brim, I think.
I'm not trying on hats.
Here, hold this, will you?
Folks, don't leave. We're going to do the Punch and Judy show.
Here it is. I knew it was here. I knew it.
Good. Now, will you get out of here?
I can't. This is my lunch hour. I got to get out of here.
What now?
My grapes are missing.
What do you mean your grapes are missing?
Look for yourself. You see any grapes in there?
Maybe they didn't put any grapes in there today.
My wife puts grapes in there every Monday.
It's Tuesday.
My tangerine is missing.
Maybe she forgot.
Come on.
Wait a minute, where are we going?
You're gonna call my wife. She'll prove it to you.
That's nonsense. I'm not gonna call anybody.
Look, I'll even pay for the call. Mr. Lewis, I owe you an apology.
You owe me an apology?
Yeah, I owe you an apology.
What do you owe me an apology for?
You know what probably happened? You see, it was probably under my money clip. You know, those things happen.
Ladies and gentlemen.
It could have been under my key.
Will you get out of here? Now, ladies and gentlemen, Punch and Judy. The Punch and Judy show is about to begin. Open up the curtain. Oh, before I open the curtain, I want you to know that this is the story of the little prince as we began. As we begin, I should say, the little prince is alone thinking of his lost love, and here it is. On with the show. Open it up, Harry.
Something? You're not only talented and handsome and charming, but you're living proof. You don't have to be an egomaniac to get ahead in Hollywood. Come in.
talk just like you do in the movies.
How about that?
Don't you remember me, Lowe's 87th Street? I'm Morty Tashman. I used to see all your pictures. You're my favorite movie star.
Well, that's perfectly understandable. I'm my favorite movie star.
Oh, I know every picture you made. I'm the world's greatest movie fan.
What a coincidence. I'm the world's greatest movie star. But I don't have time for autograph seekers right now, my good man. I'm waiting on my makeup man.
You're waiting for your makeup man?
That's right.
Psst.
What's the matter? Are you ill? What's that?
That's me. I'm your new makeup man.
Those hands on this face, are you kidding? You're a makeup man?
Well, yeah, I studied it under the GI Bill of Rights. It was a toss-up between meat cutting or makeup, so I took makeup.
You couldn't stand the sight of blood?
No, I couldn't stand the sight of meat.
Well, just be careful. You're dealing here with $1 million profile.
Oh, don't worry. Just put your stuff in my hands.
Mm. All right, let's get started.
Let's get started. That was Monogram, 1943. Dennis Morgan, Jack Carson, and Anna May Wong. Marvelous film.
I had to be a star.
I had to be a star was George Arliss and Bill Mabanke.
Never heard of it.
Never heard of it was Elmo Lincoln, Conrad Nagel, and Rex the Wonder Horse.
Was the Wonder Horse in that? Well, cut that out! Now, let's get started with this thing. You don't seem to realize that they're waiting on me out there on the set to immortalize me on celluloid. You understand?
Yes. I'm sorry. I just got carried away because movie stars are my favorite stuff. And I'll just get all this stuff ready, and you'll be so handsome when I get through. I'll make you look just like the best thing you ever saw in your life. I'll just plug this in here and just get it neat.
It doesn't have to be pressed.
It doesn't have to be pressed.
Let's go.
You're right. I'll just use it like it is. Let me just get prepared because I'm the best makeup man you ever saw. I'll make your face look like you never saw such gorgeousness, like a portrait, like the Louvre. You'll be the Mona Lisa. You'll see such gorgeous. I'll fix up. You'll be so handsome. When I get through, just to be sure that you're comfortable, I'm going to be the best. You'll be so gorgeous. There you
go. Let's! I don't need this.
Here, now you're all set, okay?
I tell you, I don't need it.
A little powder. That doesn't work out too good. See, you could get it weaved.
Stupid nincompoop.
Stupid nincompoop. That was with Leo Carrillo and...
That's Arthur. Enough of that! Look at this!
Well, look, Mrs. Stunning, not that I don't appreciate it, but no matter how this turns out, I'm going to get paid anyhow, you see?
I see. So you can't expect me to appear before my vast audience in a soiled garment.
Yeah, but there's really nothing to worry about, Mrs. Stunning. Just relax. You're tense. You have to just relax. Here, take the glass. I'll pour you some water, and you'll just relax. It's all the tense. The water will go into the glass if I could. Maybe I missed. I could. Maybe we can brush it out. See?
That's it!
That's it.
Out! Come on, that's it. Get out! Well, you're a total incompetent. I am going to have a few words to speak to the head of the studio about you. Do you understand
Mr.
that?
Mr. Stunning, I was hoping you wouldn't mention it to your father, Louis B. Stunning. After all, this is my first day on the job. I only got 30 more years before pension.
Come in!
They're ready for you on the set, Mr. Stunning.
Oh.
You have to go on a set.
I gotta go.
Haven't you forgotten something, Mr. Stunning?
Oh, yes. Let's finish up.
Yes, because they're waiting for you. You have to put that on. You see, your makeup. Now you'll see what a job I did on you? It looks like they sent down the wrong end. That was the wrong Shearer, George Bangor.
My husband is a secret agent. He's a master of disguise. He stands upon the White House lawn, camouflage from enemy eyes. So when I want to tell him what is new, I come to Pennsylvania Avenue and I talk to the tree.
I am Professor Spyro Caucus. Tonight, Tonight we will be talking about decision-making in Washington. The chief decision-maker in Washington is the president. We had hoped to have the president here tonight. He said he would definitely come. But then he decided he'd better not. Then he called to say he changed his mind and would come. However, he later said he might not. Now then, how are decisions made in our government? In most major decisions, the president consults with his cabinet.
Gentlemen, the hour is late. We've discussed this matter thoroughly. We've each had an opportunity to be heard. But gentlemen, a decision must be made. Action must be taken. Now let me make sure I have each of your positions clear. Now you ordered ham on rye, you get the tongue, without mustard. You get a tuna and tomato, and you get ham. Ham? I'll take the chopped liver. What's the difference?
Nevertheless, and notwithstanding, decision makers are well paid. A United States senator makes $30,000 a year. A Supreme Court justice makes $40,000 a year, and the president makes $100,000 a year. That may seem like a lot of money, yet a top jockey in America makes $200,000 a year. Which makes you wonder why the president doesn't learn to ride a horse. Some presidents make their decisions late at night in the privacy of their own bedroom.
Oh, golly. Mesopotamia. I don't know what I'm going to do about that. They burned our embassy again.
Send in the army.
What's that?
You should send in the army.
Send American troops to Mesopotamia? You really think so?
Well, of course. It's an insult to our flag. You can't stand for that.
You're right. I'll do it. When will the money stop? Another $2 million for a space station.
We don't need it.
We don't?
Let the Russians experiment with a space station, and then if they're successful, then we'll build one.
Let them build one first, huh?
Well, of course. Why should we take all the risks?
All right. Hello? Oh, hello, Senator. No, I was just reading some reports. The wheat subsidy? Senator Brewster, about the wheat subsidy.
Don't give it time.
I'm afraid not, Senator. He thinks I should consult with the farm board.
Nonsense. It's your decision.
Look, Senator, it's my decision. You want to know about next year?
No chance.
Forget it. Okay, Senator, good night. Well, that's enough for tonight. I think I'll turn in.
Oh, darling, before you do, I have to get a new can opener for the kitchen, and I can get an electric one, but that costs $5 more. Do you think I ought to get the regular one or the electric one?
Can't you make any of these decisions yourself?
In making decisions, the president relies heavily on the findings of poll takers. Herbert Hoover decided to build a Lincoln Highway across the United States when a poll revealed that 85% of the people favored the highway. It was later learned that most of these people owned gas stations, and the others were toll booth attendants.
Mr. Gralup, could you summarize the results of your popularity poll?
Well, Mr. President, as you can see, your popularity was still growing in this month. It reached a peak in this month and took a sharp decline in this month.
I see. And what happened between that month and that month?
You were elected.
Popular decision-making place of them all, the smoke-filled room.
Mr. President, the reason we wanted to see you is about filling the vacancy on the Supreme Court. We think it should go to Arnie Thurston.
Arnie Thurston on the Supreme Court? That's ridiculous.
But Arnie's a loyal party member, and he gave generously to your campaign.
I appreciate that, but I couldn't appoint Arnie to the Supreme Court. The man is a convicted embezzler, an extortionist. And may I remind you, at this very moment, Arnie Thurston is serving a prison term in the state penitentiary.
We don't mean now. We mean when he gets out.
Oh, he gets out.
Of course, the ultimate decision on major matters of state must be made not by the party leaders and not by the cabinet, but by the president alone.
Mr. President, the press is waiting. In fact, the whole country is waiting for your decision on the crisis. I can't hold them much longer.
You may tell the press they will have my decision in 10 seconds. We fight.
There you are, ladies and gentlemen. Now you know how decisions are made in Washington. Your government... Excuse me. Hello? Oh, yes, Mr. President. That's not how you make decisions? Well, how do you make decisions, sir? Eeny, meeny, miny, I see.
As novas aventuras intergalácticas estão a chegar. A nova Enterprise foi lançada no século 24. A nova tripulação, com personagens inesquecíveis, está pronta a partir para uma jornada recheada de emoção, aventura e novas missões a cumprir. O Caminho das Estrelas, nova geração. Sexta-feira, pouco depois da 1 da tarde, no Canal 2. A Princesa e o Pirata. Disfarçada de cigana, Margaret é a bela mulher que se põe em fuga após discussão com o pai. O navio em que viaja é capturado pelo pirata Hook, só que este terá de enfrentar grandes peripécias em relação aos reféns. Uma comédia deliciosa e divertida, bem ao gosto de Bob Hope. A Princesa e o Pirata. Cine Sábado, pouco depois da 1 da tarde, no Canal 2. Canal 2 é mesmo opção.
Ladies and gentlemen, the exciting singing voice of Dean Jones. Hit it, Louis.
No, it's not that, Jerry. I know I'm supposed to do the song here, but there's something I'd like to do first.
Oh. Okay, what'd you want to do?
Jerry, I'd like to shoot a cigarette out of a girl's mouth while looking over my shoulder into a mirror.
Hit it, Louis!
This could be fabulous, Jerry. Hold it, Louis!
Louis, will you hold it? A man is trying to be fabulous.
Look, Jerry, this could be fabulous. Now, let me get my assistant out here. Come here, Susie.
I really think that you should,
Jerry.
Yeah.
How do you like the act so far?
It could keep you off the streets.
Yeah, I knew you'd. She forgot the mirror. Give me your mirror, will you?
Wait a minute. How do you know I carry a mirror?
You're kidding. Sweetheart, get over there, will you, and put the cigarette in your mouth.
Well, wait a second. You sure you wouldn't write a thing? This could be dangerous.
Jerry, don't be silly. I've seen this done 100 times. Now, come on. Give me a drum roll, fellas.
sing.
Give me my mirror.
Sorry.
Hit it, Louie.
This time we almost made the pieces fit. Didn't we, girl? This time we almost made some sense of it. Didn't we? This time I had the answer right here in my hand, and I touched it and it had turned to sand. This time our song in tune, didn't we, girl? This time we almost made it to the moon, didn't we, girl? This time almost made our poem rhyme. This time we almost made that long hard climb. Didn't we almost make it?
Well, the paper said rain, and I meant no harm. I'm Morty Tishman. I came in answer to your ad for a boy wanted.
You came in answer to the boy wanted. Mm-hmm. What are your qualifications?
Huh?
Qualifications.
Oh, well, I'm a high school graduate, and I saw Bo Jess 12 times. Well, I'm afraid I'll have to do, huh?
Eesh. Yeah, all right, you can start by sweeping.
Sweep?
Here.
Yes.
Would you take this, please?
Take off your raincoat! You can't work in a raincoat! Take it off! Put it over there! And if you need me, I'll be in the kitchen! Well, not me!
Well, at least you're gentle. I'll enjoy this. Writing them like that anymore. Just love it, man. Excuse me, miss. Miss. Excuse me, lady.
nobody here. What's all this wiggly stuff?
Oh, that. That's a mirage, dummy. That happens out here in the desert all the time.
Oh, a mirage. You like that? A real, genuine, basic, all-purpose mirage.
Of course.
What a thrill. It's the first time I never saw one before. It was a lot of soft. Hi there. What'll it be?
I need 30 hamburgers and 14 cheeseburgers.
Let me just get my pad here.
At 30 hamburgers and 14 cheeseburgers.
Right.
18 rare, 12 medium, and the rest well. Right. Onions on 4, mustard and relish on 17. Ketchup on the rest. 12 French fries. 10 with ketchup. 2 with salt. 44 coffees, 8 black, 22 with cream and sugar. 7 with sugar alone, the rest with cream only. 43 donuts, and 1 apple pie, and make it snappy.
1 number 8 to go.
Here you are. All right. Where's the customer? What happened to the customer?
Yes, he left. You can't expect the guy to wait all day.
Hold it. Tell me, was it a bus driver kind of medium height? Don't do that while I'm talking to you. Did he have dark hair, a small scar on his cheek, and glasses, and a garnet pinky ring?
Yeah, that's him entirely.
Dummy, that was another mirage.
One more time, you're really going to let me have it, right?
Right. And another thing, either you sell his stuff, it's gonna come out of your salary.
Didn't I see you in Duel in the Sun? Every lousy prospect who crawls in here dying of thirst, we'd be out of business in a week. Water doesn't grow on trees, you know. I'm awfully sorry, but if you want a glass of Wawa, you gotta buy something.
What do I have to buy?
You gotta buy 44 hamburgers, 12 French fries, 44 coffees, 1 pie a la mode, 43 donuts, 17 of whipped cream, 9 of with ketchup, 2 cheeseburgers. You cheapskate!
To you, baby. Business is slow, and I'm afraid I'm going to have to fire you, but I don't know how to tell you.
Well, maybe, did you...
Get it out!
Oh, well, did you ever think about breaking it to me gently?
You're fired!
See, that's better than coming right out with it. Okay. Thanks for everything. Yeah, I mean, it ain't the best job I ever had, but it's been good to my sinus. Thanks, anyhow.
There goes a beautiful kid.
You know, I hate to let that kid go, but let's face it. He's just not Dinah. All right, get out of here.
Wait a minute, I'm here as a customer type person.
Oh, well, that's different. What'll it be?
I'll have 44 hamburgers, 12 french fries, 44 coffees, a piece of pie, and 43 donuts.
You're in luck. That'll be $34.50. Hold it!
I don't have to pay.
Why not?
Remember those two mirages, the girl and the bus driver?
Yeah.
I'm with them.
The smog here in the studio is murder. But on top of the smog alert, it looks like rain.
My room is across from the girls' locker room of the YWCA. There are no shades on the windows, and I see everything. So night after night, after night after night, I sing. Getting to know you.
Further adventures of Ralph Rotten, evil genius, and master of disguise. Chapter 39. As you recall, last week, we left Ralph Rotten in his never-ending struggle to stamp out the forces of goodness and niceness wherever they might be found.
Aha, Ralph Rotten strikes again. Thank you, fans of evil. Last week, as you recall, my diabolical scheme was to sneak backstage at the Miss America beauty pageant and put sand in Bert Parks' throat spray. Tonight, I am determined to move heaven and earth to win the hand of the most gorgeous girl in the world, Pamela Pulchritude, the only woman worthy of the name of Mrs. R. Rotten. While waiting the arrival of her brother, Peter J. Pulchritude, I shall request his sister's hand in marriage. Should he object? How? In a manner worthy of the exalted name of Ralph Rotten. Knock it off. Oh, hiss, I beat you. Ah, Mr. Pulchritude, how simply smashing of you to stop by. Do come in.
Thank you, Sir Liftgate. Well, well, well. So you're the man who would like to have my sister's hand.
Only if it's attached to all the other good stuff. You get the idea?
yes, I'm sure I don't know what you mean, sir.
I only meant that your sister has some very outstanding features, as it were.
Ah, I see. Oh, well, that's different. You must excuse my deep concern over my sister's welfare. Ever since our father passed away, I've been my sister's sole guardian and protector, and believe me, I would literally lay down my life to protect her honor.
I do understand. I don't know which is going to be more fun, having Pamela for a wife or you for a brother-in-law. Oh, excuse me, won't you?
Right, sir.
Hello. It's for you.
Thank you.
Hello?
Really?
I wonder who could be calling the young fool here.
Well, thank you very much. You cared. That call was from the Ace Detective Agency, and you, the man who wants to marry my sister, is none other than that arch fiend, Ralph Rotten.
You're right, I'm Ralph Rotten, but show me some mercy. Oh, you don't give a darn. Am I not of flesh and blood? Am I not entitled to a loving wife, children, happiness? A sterling brother-in-law? Try to be fair.
Yes, I'd love to, old
boy, but mercy to a scoundrel. You've committed who knows how many murders.
Yes, but just between us, when you were a youngster, didn't you sow a few wild oats?
Yes.
Now, about your sister, all I say
don't
is...
Don't mention my sister, old boy. I'd love to show mercy, but afraid I'll be forced to call the police.
Ralph Rotten strikes again. Good. Get him. Get him. Finish him. Beat him out. The egg is the best part. Strikes him in the dark meat.
Let him decide for himself.
Good. Fight. Go on. Beat him. Chew him. That's it. All of him. Good. Don't eat the leather. It's bad for you. Trouble leather. You don't need... Good. Made in Japan. It's nothing. Good. Chew it. Here, I'll help you. Good. Now back. 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 Who could that be? It couldn't be Pamela Polk, Bertrude. Who's there?
It's Pamela Polk, Bertrude.
It could be Pamela Polk, Bertrude. Coming, sweetheart. Just 1 second. Coming, sweetheart. You're right. Back. Back, you stupid fool. You know where you belong. Back. Fool. You want to give me away? Now, quiet. Couldn't be Avon.
Coming, dear.
Oh, Anthony.
Would that we were already wed. So that I might kiss your ruby red hand.
Oh, you do have a way with words.
Come, sit down, my pet. I want to talk to you.
Oh, sit, stand. I would do anything to make you happy.
Happy? Ha, 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 ha. I'll be ecstatic. Me, married to Pamela Pulchritude, the most beautiful girl in the world.
Oh.
Just think what our life together will be like. Autumn in New York. April in Paris.
A foggy day. In London town.
Oh, beautiful. And we'll have children, many children.
Yes, I'll take care of them, good care of them. Oh, yes, I'll raise them to be strong and healthy. I'll teach them to ride and fish and shoot and hunt and kill and strangle and burn and plunder and all the other good things in life.
Anthony!
Quiet! And someday they'll rule the world and carry on in the dishonorable tradition of...
Ralph Rotten!
Where? It is I. Okay, so I am Ralph Rotten. Big deal. The important thing is that I love you.
Unhand me, you villain! I despise you!
I love when you get mad and you wrinkle your nose.
Boos!
Sit out there with them, you dummy, you.
Don't you? I hate you!
You're being silly.
Take Lock. That! Marry you, I'd rather die!
As you wish. Let it never be said that Ralph Rotten didn't accommodate a lady. Charlie Green Giant, do your thing!
No!
Bite away!
No!